Praise the Lord and welcome to our Bible class lesson on this afternoon. As always, we are thankful and grateful that you have tuned in with us once again. And it's our prayer and desire that this lesson, as previous lessons, will prove to be fruitful and knowledgeable to your spiritual life and your walk with the Lord. Today, we're going to be dealing with a very, very familiar subject matter, and that's a call to ministry. I certainly believe, amen, that every individual that God has chosen, amen, to save as they have been obedient to his call, amen, God has called them not just to be church goers, amen, not just to occupy a space, but I believe that everyone that the Lord has saved, amen, he has saved them for ministry, amen. That is a contribution rather to the body of Christ. He did not save us, amen, just to sit idle or just to sit and go through a time period of waiting for the Lord to come back for us, amen, we'll be enjoying to heaven. But there's a work, amen. There's a ministry. There's something that God has called us, amen, to be able to do. And hopefully through this lesson, amen, those that are not familiar with callings, amen, will realize, amen, there's something that God has assigned to your hands. There's something in particular, amen, that the body of Christ will benefit, amen, from your service and your willingness, amen, to serve God. And you serve God as you may serve others. Every baptized believer has a personal calling for ministry. We are commissioned and sent on the mission by God. He prepares and guarantees our success if we will heed his voice and follow the plans that he has for our lives. No one has to fail in ministry. God will not give us more than we are able to handle. It is his intention that we know, plan for, and operate in the ministry that he has assigned to us. It is important that leaders recognize and utilize the talents and gifts of each local church member. In today's lesson, we will examine four pillars that assist in success of church ministry. Amen. If a local body or local church is going to be successful, amen, there must be individuals, amen, that understand their callings and are willing to operate effectively in the callings as God has called them. So again, we're going to be looking at four, amen, pillars, amen, that I feel would be helpful to us in better understanding, amen, our callings that the Lord has placed upon our life. The first pillar we'll be looking at is that simply every believer has a duty to minister. Every believer has a duty to minister. The second pillar is every ministry is important. The third pillar is each ministry is dependent upon the other. And the fourth pillar is your ministry is an expression of why God made you. Amen. So the first one we'll be able to entertain in this setting is every believer has a duty to minister. I can remember when I first got saved, amen, the very, utmost question that I had when I came to the Lord and realized that, amen, I was a sinner, I was lost, amen. I was wondering, amen, after I got saved, what's next? Amen. I already repented, baptized in Jesus' name, amen, had not yet been filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. But I was still wondering what's next. I knew the Holy Ghost was to come. But what did I do in that time frame? What did I do after, amen, being filled with the Holy Ghost? And I said that to say this is that once an individual gets saved, it opens up a whole new world for you. And that world that's opened up unto you as now a believer, amen, is that of service. God does not save anyone, amen, just to fill seats. Amen. God does not save anyone, amen, just to sit idle until the Lord come back, amen, and take us out of this earth realm. But there is some service, amen. There are some duties that he has assigned to us. Now, when I say service and duties, as I utilize those terms in this particular lesson, I'm talking about the ministry, amen, that God has called us to. I mean, most of the time you hear the word ministry, you think about preaching. But all ministry is not preaching, amen. Before you get to the preaching, there are so many other things, amen, that must take place and must be taken care of and must be done, amen. And we labor, amen, those duties and those assignments as ministry, amen, serving other individuals, amen. Pillar number one is every believer has a duty to minister. When you get saved, amen, you take on a commitment, whether it's spoken, amen, whether it's fully understood or not, amen, you take on a commitment that you're going to serve in some capacity. Amen, I can remember, amen, when I, amen, joined the military, Amen. I left home saying, I'm going to serve in the Navy. Amen. Didn't know what they wanted me to do. Amen. Did not know altogether what my job assignment meant. Amen. But I knew there was going to be some service. Amen. There was going to be something, amen, that was going to be assigned to me, something that I'm going to be responsible for. Amen. Something that is required of me to do. This is the part that I play. Amen. And if every Christian, if every believer, amen, can grasp that ideology, amen, that you are saved with a purpose. God did not save you, again, just to set out. There is something that God wants you to do that will contribute to the body of Christ. And many Christians will not find their fulfillments in church because many of them will not, amen, realize, amen, the callings that's upon their life. And many of them also will not, if you're not careful, will not understand the importance, amen, of that calling to the body of Christ. Amen. Remember this, in most cases, when you talk about service, you're talking about something that's beneficial to other individuals. Now, I know many people will think, well, I don't want to serve nobody. Well, that mindset when it comes to church has to change. Amen. Jesus Christ did not come here upon the face of the earth, amen, to do service unto himself. Amen. He came here with the mindset and he completed, amen, his obligation. He served other individuals. Amen. So likewise, amen, we have a duty, amen, to minister, to serve other individuals. Every believer is not called to serve in the same capacity or office as another. Amen. But each is called to serve. And this is where sometimes it can become, amen, somewhat foggy when other individuals start looking at how other individuals serve and they will think within themselves that's what they ought to be doing. Well, when God talks about, and we'll get a little bit deep in this lesson concerning this, but when God talks about us serving and ministering, he is talking specifically about the part that we are to play. Amen. Your part would be, in many cases, different from the part that another individual will play. Amen. It's just like your hands, amen, is used for one function. Your feet is used for another function. Your eyes is used for a totally different function. But it takes all of these different functions of the body in order for the body to be complete and be able to accomplish, amen, what is needed to be done. Amen. So every believer is not called to serve in the same capacity or office as another, but each is called to serve. It is expected that our talents, gifts, and abilities will differ one from another. Amen. Do not get into the task of weighing your calling, or weighing your, amen, your call or your ministry in comparison, amen, to another individual. I say to people many times, amen, whatever God has called you to do, amen, you give it your very best. Amen. You have a foundation within yourself that you'll be able to acknowledge and admit, amen, that I gave it my all in all. I did the very best, amen, that I was able to do. Matthew 25, verses 14 and 15 states, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods." Verse 15, "And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey." Now, this lets us see that God knows, amen, what our capabilities are. One man's capabilities will be different from another man's capabilities. And this is why we should never get into a mode of comparing, amen, our contributions, amen, to the contributions of another individual. Because when God assigns us, when God calls us to a work, when God calls us, amen, to a ministry, amen, he has already, amen, put a certain amount that he expects back from us in return. And you see here in Matthew 25, verses 14 and 15, amen, one was given 2 talents, one was given 1, and another was given 5 talents. Amen. But if you read, amen, the conclusion of that story, amen, the one that received 1, the one that received 2, and the one that received 5, amen, they were expected, amen, to double what they had. Amen. So it's critical. It's real critical that we understand as Christians, amen, that God is literally, amen, calling every believer, amen, to literally, amen, minister in some capacity. Amen. So you don't want to be saved and just sitting idle. Amen. And I say that to say this, in a way of self-examination, amen. When you look at yourself, ask yourself a serious question, amen, what contribution am I making to the body of Christ? Many times, amen, people will consider, what am I getting from the body of Christ? Well, there's nothing to get from the body of Christ if a contribution is not made towards the body of Christ. So the first question of consideration, amen, that every Christian should ask, amen, if you're saved and you're in a local assembly, you should ask the question, amen, what contribution am I making, amen, to the body of Christ? We all have a responsibility to minister to the world and in the church. Our service as we represent the body of Christ is not optional. And I want Christians to understand this. Sometimes, amen, the believer may get upset by the way things are going in the local assembly, and they'll say, well, I'm just not going to do anything. Well, God did not call us, even though we may get upset, God did not call us, amen, to make a decision that we're not going to do anything. Amen. He called us to service. You'll see that a lot clearer as we look at some scriptures, amen, as we go further. Every baptized believer is spiritually drafted into the army of God. Amen. Every believer, amen, is spiritually drafted into the army of God. Now, what that means is that when you got saved, amen, you sign up, amen, to do whatsoever the Lord will assign you to do. And we just saw here briefly, every assignment, amen, is different one from another. Amen. So don't get caught up in what the assignment is. We're going to look at the weight of those assignments, amen, in a little bit later on in this lesson. And we'll see, amen, that one assignment that God may assign one individual and the other assignment may assign another individual is just as important as the assignment you're looking at of the other individual. We have been called to minister with a purpose. We say we have a duty to minister. You must have the mindset that you have been called to minister with a purpose. Amen. In other words, amen, God is looking for an outcome. Amen. We would call it sometime, amen, a return. Amen. We're looking for something, amen, to be produced. So everything you're doing for the Lord, there's a reason behind it. Amen. So we have been called to minister with a purpose. Let's look at 2 Timothy 1:9, which clarifies it a little bit better for us. Who have saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. So even before the world began, amen, Jesus called us, amen, with a purpose. And amen, your purpose will not necessarily be, amen, in comparison to what the next person's purpose may be. But at the same level, amen, your purpose is just as important. Every individual has been gifted for the purpose of ministry. God will not ask you to do something that you cannot do. And amen, one of the fail-falls of saints sometimes, amen, is comparing their contribution and comparing their ability, amen, to another Christian. Don't get caught up in that trap, amen, because what you contribute, amen, towards your service in ministry is just as important as what the other person is contributing as God has called them to serve. Amen. Members are needed for the purpose of ministry. When you talk about, amen, every believer has a duty to actually minister. Amen. We must also remember that members are needed for the purpose of ministry. Amen. Church can be no better than what you are. Amen. You are the body of Christ. Amen. The scripture says members in particular. Amen. So let's look at 1 Corinthians 12:27 and see if we can, amen, get a further insight. Amen. From what, amen, the author's trying to get us to see here. Amen. 1 Corinthians 12:27. Now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. So we see from 1 Corinthians 12:27 is that members are needed for the purpose of ministry. Amen. If you don't have anybody, amen, willing to serve in ministry, that does not signify there is not a need. Amen. What it shows more than anything is that members are not available. Amen. We want to always be available for the service and for the work of God. If God thought enough, amen, to cut out of his eternal time schedule, amen, to embody himself as a human being, amen, and suffer the sufferings that he suffered. I mean, the Bible says he tasted death for every man, and yet, amen, redeem us, amen, by his sacrificial death, amen, the least we can do, amen, is cut out enough time, amen, to serve him in this life cycle that he has given us, amen, a responsibility towards our services. Amen. The next thing we want to see is those that minister will be rewarded by the Lord. Amen. God will not ask you to do something, amen, without a reward attached to it. Amen. And God knows that we are people, amen, that like to receive something, amen, in some manner or some form. So you can rest assured those that minister will be rewarded by the Lord. Let's look at Colossians 3 in verse number 24. Colossians, amen, chapter number 3 and verse number 24. Knowing that of the Lord, you shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Knowing that of the Lord, ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Amen. So the Lord is going to, amen, make sure you're blessed, amen, in return, amen, for your service that you render, amen, towards, amen, serving other individuals. Pillar number two, every ministry is important. When you talk about having a call to ministry, amen, many times, amen, people start picking out, amen, when they're dealing with callings, what they think is most important, amen. But every facet and every portion of any service in ministry is to be considered as important. Amen. Your hands cannot do what your eyes do. Amen. Your ears cannot do, amen, what your mouth do. Amen. So every part of our body, amen, has been set in a particular place, amen, to function, amen, for the whole of the body. Amen. So when we talk about, amen, where am I going to serve? You know, some people say, well, I want to do this because I feel like it'll give a greater return. Amen. No, do not look at ministry that way. Amen. God calls you, amen, according to how he wants you to serve. And we're going to look at it and see a little bit later on. Amen. There are several things about you that will determine, amen, how you will be able to serve. So every ministry is important. That's pillar number two. In order for the church to be effective or accomplish the purpose and will of Christ, it must function as a body. Amen. So you don't want the body getting in an argument, amen, with each other about who is most important, who is most needed. Amen. Every part of the body, amen, has been set in a particular, amen, status, in a particular place, amen, that it aids the whole of the body. Amen. So you don't want to get into thinking, amen, that my part, amen, carries more weight than somebody else's part. Amen. You can be the greatest orator, the greatest speaker, the most anointed speaker there is, but if there are no parishioners there to receive your word, amen, then your words are not needed. Amen. And then you could have a million people gathered, amen, to receive a word from the Lord and the preacher. There's no preacher there. Amen. Those people coming together would be in vain. Amen. So God has connected the body in such a fashion that it cannot do one without the other. And so many times, amen, we start grouping, amen, which parts of the body, amen, that we feel, amen, is the most important. Every part of the body, amen, is important because it makes up the whole of the body. The body of Christ does not have important and unimportant members. Amen. There are no members when you talk about the body of Christ, amen, where you can label them as important or unimportant. Amen. All members of the body, amen, are important, amen, in the eyes of God. Amen. The body of Christ, amen, should be seen in that fashion, and certainly the body of Christ, amen, has to operate in that fashion. Every member is important. Therefore, the ministry of each individual is important. Some ministries are visible and some are behind the scenes, but all are equally important. Ministries that seem small and aren't very visible make preparation for the larger, more visible ministries. Amen. There'll be a lot of things that will take place, amen, behind the scenes, amen, that the congregation and parishioners at whole will not know everything that goes into, amen, that ministry, amen, to make everything work like it work. Amen. Many times, amen, as you give honor to different individuals, amen, there will be times and many times where certain names will never be called. But if it wasn't for those entities, amen, ministering in the capacities in which they actually minister, amen, then something would go lacking. And even to the point, amen, not just lacking, but in some cases, you won't be able to do what you are actually doing. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and let's look at verses 18 and verse number 20. But now have God set the members, every one of them in the body, as it has pleased him. Look at verse number 20. But now are they many members, yet but one body. Amen. So what God has done to help us to understand that every minister is important, amen, he has taken of himself, amen, as 2 Corinthians 12 and 18 states, amen, to set members, every one of them in the body as it has pleased him. Amen. So the calling that you have on your life is the calling that God placed on your life. Now, no one should dishonor, amen, what God has called you for. Amen. God thought enough of you and your ability, which he gives to every man, amen, to be able to perform that particular ministry that's going to aid, amen, to the whole of the body. So what is my responsibility when I recognize my calling, amen, when I recognize what my ministry is to not start trying to make it more puffed up than the other ministries, amen. But we're going to see a little as we go on further, amen. These ministries and different ministries throughout the body of Christ are intended to work in conjunction, amen, one with the other. So if you start dividing one being greater than the other, amen, then we brought about a spirit of disunity. Let's look at pillar number three, amen. And I spilled into it just a little bit earlier as we were going along. Each ministry is dependent upon the other. Each ministry is dependent upon the other, amen. We are not in this world, amen, an island to ourselves, amen. God made humanity in such a fashion, amen, that we need each other, amen. That's why God created family unit, amen, because there's a need, amen, that's supplied, amen, one to the other. And so it is when you talk about the body of Christ, you talk about the church, you talk about the different offices in the church, you talk about the different levels of responsibility, amen, all of them feed into the same melting pot. And let me just say this, if you find anyone doing anything in church, amen, that you will label as ministry or service to individuals, and it's not feeding into one main pot or to one main purpose or to one main cause, then that's not a ministry, amen, that was set up by God. You may have somebody, amen, operating in their own self, amen, will or self-desire. And you don't want to be operating in self-will and self-desire. Amen. You want to understand that God called you, amen, to do what you do, amen, because it serves to the whole of the purpose, amen, of that local ministry. Each ministry is intertwined with other ministries for the purpose of accomplishing God's intended purpose. Without this interconnection, division would exist, amen. If ministry was not, amen, set up by God, amen, to intertwine, amen, with the other ministries, amen, what you will literally be setting up, amen, will be, amen, units of division. And the Bible said a house divided against itself, amen, it cannot stand, amen. So you want to make sure that all ministries, amen, in a local, amen, congregation, amen, a local church, amen, feed into the whole of the purpose, amen, of that ministry. Each ministry should be viewed like the pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. It takes each piece to complete the picture. Amen. You can have the most beautiful jigsaw puzzle, amen, that has ever been created. Amen. And you get down to the end of putting that puzzle together. And now you discover, amen, one piece is missing. Amen. That jigsaw puzzle cannot have, amen, its complete glory or complete purpose. Amen. Because that one piece is missing. And that one piece, amen, is identified, amen, through all the different, amen, ministries that serve, amen, in a local congregation. The missing piece of that puzzle usually become the most important piece, amen, the piece that nobody, amen, thought nothing of until you come down now to, amen, the final piece of that puzzle, and all of a sudden, amen, that one piece, amen, becomes the most glorified piece, amen, because the glory of that puzzle cannot be enjoyed until all of the whole of that, those pieces, amen, come to finality to complete that picture. Ministers intended to have a positive effect on others. If we fail to wholeheartedly serve in our ministries, there will be negative and unintended outcomes. Amen. So I want you to see here, amen, when we talk about ministries, amen, being dependent upon each other, amen, you don't want to get into a thing of separating ministries. Amen. This is our service and this is our day and this is our part. Amen. You have to find a way, amen, that each of those ministries are intertwined together, amen, to operate, amen, like a body would operate, amen. You may have need to get up from where you are, amen, and go somewhere, amen, go downtown and pick up some medicine. I'll use an example you need. Well, just in the normality of moving, your feet got to interact. Amen. Your body is becoming weak because you need that medicine. Amen. But now your feet got to interact. Amen. And get you to that location. Amen. That you can purchase that medicine that you need. Amen. Your eyes going to play a part of identifying, amen, what this medicine is. Amen. As you deal with the pharmacy, your ears going to play a part. Amen. As you purchase that medicine, amen, as you deal with what the cost is. So all of these, amen, different parts of the body play a part just for the sole purpose, amen, of you, amen, picking up that medication that your body needs that you might feel better. 1 Corinthians 3:8 states, now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. Amen. So we see in 1 Corinthians, amen, the importance, amen, of us understanding, amen, that each ministry is dependent one upon another. Do not start making one more important than the other. Amen. To do so again, amen, will create schism, division, amen, in the body. Amen. Let's look at pillar number 4, if you will, which is your ministry is an expression of why God made you. Amen. When you realize, amen, what your ministry is, when you realize what your calling is, amen, you can clearly start beginning to see that your ministry is an expression of why God made you. Amen. In other words, when God created you, even in your infinite state, amen, God had purpose in mind of what part, amen, you would play, what contribution, amen, would you make in your service, amen, towards, amen, the body of Christ. According to Psalms 139, each of us was uniquely designed by God to do certain things. We must serve in the capacity for which God has made us. He has intentionally given each of us gifts differing one from the other. He intentionally did that. Amen. So do not start, amen, lusting after another man's, amen, gift. Do not start, amen, looking down on your gift as being insignificant. Amen. When God started, amen, dividing into us, amen, gifts for the purpose of ministry, amen, he took it upon himself to look at us individually and decide, amen, what he would gift us with that we can in return, amen, serve the body of Christ. If we do not understand our gifts, we end up doing things that God never intended or designed for us to do. And God knows, I've been in church long enough, I've seen folk doing things that God never, amen, called them, amen, to minister in that capacity. And when that happens in a person's life, amen, they're going to find themselves, amen, creating chaos instead of adding to, amen, the whole of the ministry of that local church. Amen. So you want to make sure that you're in sync with God and you understand, amen, that the calling in which you are striving to minister, amen, that you feel you're called into, amen, it works in sync, amen, with the whole of that local ministry. Romans 12:6 states, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. And one part I wanted you to see in Romans 12:6 is having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. Amen. So we will have, amen, different gifts. Amen. God will grant to us individually, amen, the ministry that he assigned to us. Amen. Consider this for thought, if you will. Our physical and mental impairments do not hinder us from utilizing the gifts that God has given to each of us. For example, many cannot read music, but they're able to play it. Some are mentally challenged, but they're able to paint beautiful paintings. Others have no hands, but they play an instrument with their feet. And the list could go on and on, amen, because even though there are impairments, and even though there are, amen, different levels of abilities, amen, that each human being may have, different one from the other, amen, it's God that has gifted us, amen. It's God that has looked upon us, amen, and said, I assign, amen, this particular minister, this particular service, amen, to you. And he is assigned to you, amen, based on the ability that he has given to you. Amen. Listen a little further, if you will. Each individual should consider the following 5 areas of experience that will influence the kind of ministry they are best fitted for. And this list is not conclusive by any means, amen. And there could have been many different things on this list that you can consider, amen. But I wanted to put together some things that were kind of, amen, start, amen, jugging your thought, amen, about, amen, you, amen, being able to conclude, amen, to the type of ministry that you're best fitted for. Amen. If you don't like music, amen, God has not called you to be a musician. If you can't sing, amen, you may have a desire to sing, but if you can't sing, and I mean just out of all your efforts, I can't sing. I can't even remember the words to the song. Amen. I don't know what a key is. Amen. I keep creating keys every time I sing. Well, God has not called you to be a songstress. But that does not mean that there's not a calling in your life. Amen. So you have to be able to identify, amen, even within your own self, amen, some trademarks that would better help you to understand, amen, the callings that God has placed upon your life. I can remember a young man I was talking to some few years back, and he said he felt the Lord had called him to ministry, but he don't like large crowds. Wow. So now, if I don't like large crowds and I'm called, amen, to preach to individuals, I've limited the number, amen, of people that will be saved under my ministry. Amen. Let's just say my limit is 50 people. I don't like over 50 people. I lose it, you know. So now God called me to be a preacher, amen. And now 150 people show up, amen. So now I'm not able, amen, to minister. And I'm saying that to say this. Amen. God is not going to put you in an atmosphere and upon your calling, amen, that does not fit you as a person. Now, there's some edges that must be, amen, smoothed down amongst all of us, amen, to better ourselves on our callings. But I'm talking here just direct deficiencies and inabilities. Amen. God will not put you in a state of inability and you're just not able to do, even with a calling, and yet God called you to that. That's not how God functions. Amen. So to help us, amen, as Christians and as believers, amen, better understand, amen, for our own self-consolation, amen, whether I've been called, amen, to a certain ministry, amen, consider these 5 points, if you will. Consider, first of all, your educational experiences. What were your favorite subjects in school? All of us go through modes of learning. Our first mode of learning, of course, is our teaching we get from our parents. The second mode normally of learning is what we get from secondary school. And then, of course, from there to higher levels of learning. Amen. So when you start considering your callings, amen, you got to know something about what you're doing. Amen. So what is your educational experience? What were your favorite subjects in school? Amen. God is not going, amen, position you in a place that is outside of your perimeter. Amen. What were your vocational experiences? What jobs have you enjoyed and been successful at doing? Amen. You can start kind of looking towards those areas to help you identify, amen, the particular call or ministry that God is calling you to. And then the next thing you want to consider is, what are your spiritual experiences? Amen. How has God been dealing with you? In what capacity has God used you the most? Amen. You'll find, amen, that can be a doorway as well to helping you, amen, understanding, amen, your call to ministry. Amen. If you don't like, again, dealing with people, I don't like talking to people, I don't like being around people, amen, then you're probably not called to be a Sunday school teacher. Amen. So I want you to understand, amen, God will position us, amen, according to our abilities. All of our abilities, amen, and experiences are different. Amen. The next thing you want to look at, amen, what were your painful experiences? Now, you might say, what do painful experiences have to do with me determining, amen, what God is calling me to? Well, once you overcome a painful experience, amen, and other folk have going through some of the same thing what you're going through, you become a better candidate to be able to minister to those individuals, amen, especially after you have overcome and help them through what they have not been able to overcome at that period in their life. So consider your painful experiences. Where have you experienced hurt in the past and have overcome? Amen. Some of the best sexual abuse counselors, amen, that are noted to be great in their profession is counselors that have been abused. Amen. Some of the best alcoholic advisors about how to overcome the pitfalls of alcoholism is those individuals that used to be alcoholics, amen, and have defeated, amen, that hindrance that was upon their life. Amen. So your painful experiences, amen, do not altogether eliminate you from serving, amen, in that ministry, in that capacity. In our closing remarks, just remember this. Ministry becomes most rewarding when we are able to use our spiritual gifts and abilities in the areas of our heart's desire. Amen. God is not going to call you to do something, amen, that you will not find, amen, a desire in your heart to do. Amen. We must always be guided by the Spirit, our personality, and the quality of our experiences. Let us all be mindful that we have been called to minister to others. So I pray in this short session today you've heard something, amen, that will, amen, enlighten your desire, amen, for the call of ministry. Amen. I would encourage, amen, every baptized believer, amen, if you're not serving in some capacity, amen, get busy in your church. Amen. There's work to be done. Amen. Everybody's calling, everybody ministry, amen, is not going to be the same. Amen. If you have everybody in the church, amen, ministering in the exact same capacity, there's a lot lacking in that local church. Amen. So do not, amen, look small upon, amen, the type of ministry that God called you to. Amen. God will fit you upon that local, amen, congregation, and in that local congregation, amen, that your ministry and your service, amen, would be just as important and just as needful, amen, as the other ministries that you may view, amen, taking place in that local congregation. So you be blessed, amen, and you continue, amen, to look towards the Lord for his guidance, amen, as you consider your ministry, your callings, and God will enlighten you, amen, upon what he has assigned to your hand. So we be able to meet again. You remain safe. You continue to look towards our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who will continually, amen, provide for your needs. Be blessed till we meet again.